big part of the whole, you know, big picture of my career, and one of my favorite singers, you know, out there. And I think more people should know the name Doug Henthorn, because he really is a very undiscovered gem from America's heartland of Indiana, who can sing wonderfully at 11:30 a.m., which is hard enough to begin with as a singer, with a shot of tequila on his back in a vocal booth singing a Led Zeppelin song. So there you go, Doug. Put that on your credit reel, you know, your resume. Why do I need a label to pick my songs? Why do I need a label to give me, for better or worse terms, Shylock rates on royalty and ultimately drop me at the end of the day because I don't sell 1.5 million copies in the first 2 weeks and they don't hear a single? You mean to tell me if that's the only way to do it? Because that was the belief. No single, no, you got to know the right people, you got to know the right answers, you got to wear the right shoes and have the right stylist. And all that was predicated, and that entire house was built on a foundation made of toothpicks.
Sony had started to have financial problems, and all of a sudden they became less attracted in the blues genre of music. You know, what a surprise. And so Joe and I decided at that point that we were going to become a big fish in a little pond and embrace the blues, unlike the major labels would ever do, because it never has enough appeal to them. So we decided that we'd embrace the blues. We'd start to make his own records on our own company, J&R Ventures, and that we felt that would be the best way to go, because at this point, up until then, we had seen through Bloodline and through Joe's own personal experience at a record company that the record companies are not stable.
And Roy figured that out before anybody. And when they write the book about him, because they always say when they write the book, but when they write the book about him, they'll say that he was fearless enough to take him on and he beat him.
And we, Joe and I, were committed to doing this for a career forever. And we had made that promise to one another many years ago. This is what we want to do. It's not about the money. It's about doing what we want to do. And that's what J&R Adventures is all about, which is a beautiful thing. Because from that point forward, Joe has made records the way he wants to make records. It's a very unusual recording process, unlike the typical process with a record label in the record business, where you have A&R executives, you have a producer, you have an artist, and you got a lot of people in the kitchen making a record up beyond the artist and the producer. At J&R Adventures, it's just Joe and Kevin making a record. I never hear the music until it's done, nor am I interested in hearing it until it's done, because at J&R Ventures, it's about making a record that fits Joe, that's about Joe. It's not about radio, and it's not about commerciality. It's about making a great record. So much so that we never even think of radio. We don't even work radio at J&R Ventures. We let the fans tell us what they like, and that's our audience. And with that, Joe's records are eclectic, because they're not geared to one genre, and nor do they have to be. So he and Kevin get to go in there. They get to make a great record. No one's saying, well, I don't hear a hit. We wouldn't want to know what to do with a hit if we made a hit to begin with. So it's cool. You know what I mean? So it's an interesting culture of how Joe's been able to grow up and become a recording artist in his own world with Kevin Shirley, and the two of them truly get to create without any intrusions from the record industry. And it's a wonderful thing.
His greatest work is what he's done with the promoters and turning the game around, where we used to have an agent and we used to wait for promoters to offer us to give us an offer to play a show. And we'd chase offers like it was dartboard routing, going, you're in Boise, Idaho today, next day you're in Chicago, and you'd be on the bus, and you'd be living on the bus because it's another 12 or 13 hour drive to the next city. Roy said, what happens if I promote my own shows?
5-6 years ago, Joe was playing the clubs, and I wanted to get him out of the clubs and into a more prestigious venue, because I believe that the venue you play also says a lot about the kind of star that you are. And I was not able to get the concert promoters in the industry around the world to want to put Joe into these theaters, because the theaters are very expensive to rent. And by the time you rent them, you pay advertising and pay the artists, it's a big overhead against the amount of tickets you have to sell to necessarily break even. And at that time, it was too much risk for them to want to think that Joe could play one of these top venues. So in order to be able to make that paradigm shift, and I believed in, like, it would become a self-fulfilling prophecy of, like, either we play those venues and then you become a bigger star and you become a bigger talent, or you don't and then you never become a bigger star or bigger talent. So we had to make that shift happen. So I decided I was going to rent these theaters through J&R Ventures, and that Joe and I would decide to become our own promoter. Now, this is after we decided we were going to become our own record company.
I said, really, we're going to do that? He goes, it's an experiment. If we fail, we don't, everybody's getting coal in their stockings for Christmas because we're going to lose a bunch of money. But if we win, it's a proof of concept. I remember this conversation very clearly. And it started in Jacksonville, Florida, because our company's going to promote the Jacksonville show. And we're going to promote the Fort Wayne, Indiana show. And we didn't sell out the rooms, but we were able to pay the expenses of the night and make more money not selling out the place, but playing the right place, than if we had taken the offer to play the club, which is where the promoters thought this music should be in.
So at that point, once we started to rent our own theaters in America to start, we began to have success, that the people would come to the theaters. And of course, we had to charge higher ticket prices, not because we wanted to make more money, but because it cost more money to rent the theater, to bring in better sound, to bring in better lights, right, to have better personnel. So everything, as you move up and up in the system, everything becomes more and more expensive. But at the same time, you have a much more professional presentation. And of course, what you see is what you believe. And in Joe's case, he's such a strong talent that if you put him into a great venue like that, you walk out thinking you had one of the greatest, theater experiences you've seen in a long time.
And there was the glass ceiling. There was the ceiling going, I see it up there, but you can't, but because you're blues, you can't go there. And Roy was the guy who said, I don't buy that. And so all this, really, this week, all of my tours, it's really his playbook that he wrote. And my biggest joy is watching Roy get the credit and watching Roy have fun with this thing and able to build it up to where we can put on the kind of production show, get the sound and lights the way we want it, do everything that a major act in a pop genre can do, only we do it on our own terms. It's the music that I've played since day one, which was implicitly explained to us how that was an impossibility. Seeing Aurora Borealis during the day was more feasible than what we were, quote unquote, trying to do, according to music business experts who are no longer, quote unquote, in the music business.
So by taking over the concerts, we were able to now get Joe into the best venues in America and then around the world. And now here we are this week playing, Royal Albert Hall, Hammersmith, Apollo, Shepherd's Bush Empire, and Borderline, all of which were sold out, all of which was a massive event and a major experience for Joe and for his fans, and a statement in his career that people are talking about at this moment is something really impressive, and we're really proud of that.
So that's a real chuckle. And Roy and I are like brothers. He's 10 years older than me. And we have the same kind of sense of humor. And we have the same innate drive to make things better. And willingness to pony up and do something like this week and spend hundreds of thousands of dollars, you know, on something that we believe in without a guarantee that it'll work. Because we don't believe that playing it safe gets you anywhere. So, and that's Roy Wiseman. He's also known in these parts of the world, especially in Central Europe, where the sausages and the cheese and everything, and the olives are highly tuned. He's also known as the king of snacks, because that man knows food. He is truly, I sound like Charlton Heston. Every time we travel on the bus, especially in Europe, I have weight issues, so I go up and down, so I can't even partake. I just look. But he'll come upstairs on the bus, and he'll have this tray that looks like it's out of Home and Garden magazine. I mean, it's perfectly placed, and he puts it on the table, and I always go to him like Charlton Heston. I go, "You truly are the king of snacks." And he gets great joy of feeding people. I mean, there's no better joy. Seeing a gig or you know, watching people, you know, he loves to see people happy. And that's if he's out in the road, he's usually in the lobby listening to people talk on the way out. And he loves to see people happy. And then he comes in and he feeds the band. So that's why the band gets great.
Royal Albert Hall is one of the venues that every musician longs to play, and once you do it once, nobody can take it away from you, you know.
Yeah, no, the acoustic show, we did a 2-week run, and a lot of people didn't get an opportunity to see. They get to see an acoustic, you know, part of the show now that he does it in the act, and that's come out of having done the Vienna thing. But the way we structured it with these different instruments, the Irish fiddle and the Swedish nickel harper, and some of the more interesting arrangements and instruments that we have in there. They haven't got to see this, and I thought this would be a wonderful opportunity to, you know, it's also part of the bookend. It's finishing. This is what we did. It's not just bongos and an acoustic guitar. It's these percussion instruments that Lenny's come up with, and these traditional instruments from different countries, and it's just a reprise of that.
I'm using a very eclectic combination of instruments that come from all over the world. I'm using a cajon, which has a bass drum pedal inside of it. It's a box which actually originated from Peru. I'm using some frame drums from the Middle East. I'm using a djembe, which is from Africa. I'm using our washboard, which is American, you know, an actual washboard, playing that, and a couple of other drums and some shakers and cowbells. It's a very nice combination of stuff.
Basically, overall, we're using Les Pauls, 59s and 60, and today we'll have a couple of special guests at the Royal Albert Hall, not people, but guitars.
I'd like to thank, again, my friend Donald Gallagher and his son for loaning me this guitar, my friend Phil for loaning me that beautiful Peter Green Gary Moore guitar, and my friend Bernie Marsden for loaning me his guitar. So it's been a guitar fest up here with all my friends and guitar geeks. It's like a party for guitar geeks at the Royal Albert Hall. It's like, how fun. But here's a song from our way back, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
such an important gig as Royal Albert Hall, we're glad to have some friends who want to bring us some special guitars, but of course we have some special ones, the African and Spot, which you saw before, and a couple other cool things. And mainly today it will be a Les Paul day.
I can't get this smile off of my face. It's been such an incredible evening. It's been such an incredible week. I'm gonna go home and I probably won't sleep for 48 hours. My wife is gonna tell me to shut up a million times because I can't stop talking about it. My dog will probably run away from me. But this has been just a wonderful experience. It's been great to see you and all the guys here and your staff who I love so much. It's just been a wonderful experience, and I can't say enough better things about it.
You know, it's always a thrill to play here, don't you think? It's a special place.
It's great to be a part of it and break it up a little bit. You know, you got the main band, and then we come in and play a couple of things.
And I can have a drink while they play. It's
I give them a little break.
Yeah, you should come every time.
Then I come at the end and wave off. He's done all the hard work.
That was great. Really, really a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was rock and roll, complete rock and roll. That, and I enjoyed the acoustic band tonight as well. Because in the acoustic band, I listened from the house. I didn't use my monitors, and the sound of the house was absolutely amazing. I had the sound of the Royal Albert Hall, you know, within me.
I'm shedding many tears. Seems I can't shed no more.
Oh, I love it. It's great. I mean, it's really honest, and of course, that music, the acoustic music, sounds so rich in the Albert Hall because the Albert Hall is designed for that kind of music, and so it's like, oh, so big. So it's great. It was great.
They all were. They all were very different. You know, one was a blues night, one was a full-out rock show, and this one, it was just everything combined all together. It was quite nice. But we're happy with it. We're happy to shoot it. Hopefully the audience will be happy with it too. It'll be a great, great week.
I think we almost saved the best for last. It was a great show. It was a Royal Albert Hall was a fantastic show. All of them have been fantastic, you know, really. Not everything went exactly as planned, as you well know from your side too. But mostly, I think we're absolutely well covered. Joe played amazing. I think he's dead exhausted now. I think he's about to fall down.
Home run. Home run. Reggie Jackson in October, buddy. We just hit it out of the park. Bonamassa is like, you can rely on him. He's Mr. October. And I just thought that he performed amazingly. And what can I say, he's the best partner anyone could ever have. You know, with him in your corner, you're guaranteed to win every time. And it was a hell of a big. It was great. And my kids loved it, the family, they loved it. They thought it was great. And Adamasa, he looked amazing. I mean, the suits he wore were great. And he really stood up there and he owned the stage. And he performed in a way that you knew that he had arrived. This is a man that has confidence and knows what he's doing when he's on stage. I thought the show was amazing.
Humbling experience for anybody, and it's bigger than any artist that I saw it when Eric Clapton walked in. And I saw it when I've played there a few other times subsequently for different events. That the hall is bigger than anybody else, and the reverence that us musicians have and anybody has for the hall itself, you know, really dictates the gig and the magnitude of the gig. So kind of almost opening up for ourselves, doing an hour set on the acoustic, and then coming out and do about an hour and a half with the electric band. And we have some great musicians. The world's, sitting in a hotel right now full with the world's greatest musicians. We have some of the world's best guitars showing up, guest guitars. And it's just, again, but when I finish the last note of the last song, I'm going to sit on the drum riser and I'm going to look out. And I'm just going to sit there for a couple minutes and be thankful that it's come to this point and that we've been able to pull this off. So.
I survived. That's my first impression. I'll tell you, this gig here, the difference between this gig and the one 4 years ago, I felt more comfortable, more at ease with the enormity of the room. Where 4 years ago, I couldn't stop looking out and couldn't stop, going, wow, look how big this place is, And I still did that tonight. But the difference was I think I felt more at ease and comfortable with the result. And I felt that we had a really strong set list, and I felt that we had a really good program, in store. And when you go out there and you're confident in what you're doing, just the set list is, the execution is another thing, but the set list, I thought the set list was strong. It was like a celebration of every facet of my career, acoustic, electric, old, new, young, old. And it for me, was a great way to wrap up the week. With that said, I am probably the most exhausted human being on the planet, other than the people that do endurance training or the Iditarod or something like that. This has been a real challenge for me. I mean, it's been a real challenge. It's been a real joy, but it's been a real challenge. And I think this was
designed to be special for the fans, where they get to see every aspect of it from start, from the very the impetus to the kind of like, well, we're just trying to find ourselves into the greatest venue in the world, the Royal Albert Hall. And, you know, I can't thank them enough for having me back, and hopefully we didn't tear up the place, and they like us and they'll have us back. But they're just, you know, it's a wonderful venue to play, and it's just a wonderful, you know, they're wonderful people, you know. And the heritage here is just second to none. You're gonna just, you know, what can you say? So I can say this, I'm exhausted. That's all I can say.
It's been an amazing and hard road to get to this point. As now, over the last 3 or 4 years, as his career has been kind of setting in and people are accepting that he is the future of blues rock, that he is truly this generation's best blues rock player. And now that the shows are going well, I feel really, I'm very proud of the situation. I feel very accomplished. And it's a nice time in my life to be able to get up, go to work, know that we were right, you know, that all those years where it was a struggle, where we weren't making any money, but believing in our future and what we wanted to accomplish, and now here we are. And you know, I think for any person who is focused and trying to accomplish something, you know, when you get to that place where you finally can say to yourself as a human being, you know, my hard work paid off, I can hold my chin high, I can look people in the eye and say I was right, and that just makes you feel complete as a person. And so now I feel complete as a person. Now that I can say that this is, you know, really real. And now I'm looking forward to the next 20 years, right, that Joe and I will have together. And just continuing to make music history our way. Because that's all we want to do, is just go out and Joe wants to perform. I want to promote shows and be in the music business and do what we do. And we like to have fun. And we don't like to do it in a way that's stressful. We like to have, you know, at J&R Ventures, we have a corporate culture like Coca-Cola or, you know, any major corporation. And our corporate culture is one of we want to have fun and we want to do it in a relaxed way and enjoy our lives. Because life is short, so why make it stressed, right? So now that we're here and we're doing it in this way, we're having a lot of fun. Both Joe and I are enjoying ourselves. And we have a great set of people around us, from Joe's musicians to his crew, and the people at J&R Ventures in our office that make it happen every day. So we're really lucky.
That's where I think this is going to be the end of that, Joe, and all the different experimentation we've done in the albums up to now. And 2014, we'll see JB Mark III. We have to trust each other, and he has to trust me as a producer, otherwise we're never going to work. But given that we have this relationship that we do, it's absolutely symbiotic. You know, we live 2 miles from each other. We have dinner together. We talk about, you know, we have a friendship, and somehow when we get together as friends, all we talk about is music and the show and where to go. It's like, it's, you know, it's an ongoing thing. For us, it's perpetual, not only because it's our work, but because it's our love as well.
Oh, really?
Right here.
And right across the street is where the McCarries
is. I love guitar. I'll never, you know, that's my pilot light. On every stove has a pilot light. My pilot light is that little flame beneath it all that's constantly burning, and that's me and the guitar. The minute that goes out and it becomes a means to an end or a way to make a living, so it's the minute I walk away, because I've seen it before. I've seen it before in 2011 when I toured with Black Country Communion. Not in the sense that the members of the group I was in had that, because they were all very passionate players. It's when we did shows with other rock bands or other, you know, bands, not to mention any names, but there was some element of the thrill has been way gone for them. And they're just up there going through the motions, and they don't care about the gear, they don't care about, you know, they play fine, they sing fine. But then they all go off and they're more interested in the lifestyle and the being recognized vis-a-vis. I'm more happy. You don't see me trying to make the scene. I'm happy down in the basement of the hotel looking at 59 Sumbers, Les Pauls. And that's the pilot light. And that's the geek in me that'll never, hopefully, you know, leave. And I wear Guitar Geek shirts, you know. I have a Gibson coat, you know. I have a keychain that's made out of a truss rod cover, you know. I am that guy. I have a vegetable grater that looks like a flying V. Good, bad, or otherwise, that's me in a nutshell. It doesn't necessarily make it right, but I'm more happy at a guitar shop than walking through the velvet rope and having the guy go, oh wow, you know, then photographers click, that's for somebody else, that's not me, you know, sitting there with, you know, Drambuie shots, you know, talking to supermodels, that's somebody else's life. Me, and you can ask my lovely girlfriend Sandy Tom, that at home it's painfully geeky, and it's painfully, I am that guy, unfortunately, you know. It's like there's no rousing house parties. No, what am I doing tonight? I'm retubing an amp, or I'm restringing a guitar, or I'm sitting in front of the television, torturing her while she's trying to watch her favorite programs with the guitar. You know, geeking out over a Dumble amp, or looking at pictures of guitars, or looking at guitars on the internet that I would like to buy, maybe, you know, or looking at other pictures of somebody else's 59 from a different angle, a guitar that I've already seen before and played, or maybe even owned, but because it's at a different angle, and now I want it back. Well, I can't have it back, but that's the problem. So, see, ladies and gentlemen, as advertised, I'm just the guitar geek. It never changed. It hasn't changed since age 4, and hopefully it'll never change. It's hard to find these.
Just grab a seat if you want. Are those the cases with the speakers in them?
No, that was the silver tone. All right, come on, I'm done.
Hmm.